We were looking at equalizers and how to adapt them, and a common way of adaptation of equalizers is to use this gradient descent algorithm which I mentioned. This is a general thing that can be used whenever you have a linear combination. Y is a linear combination of n different things, and you have some target, okay. And basically, you want to make sure that y is as close to the target as possible, okay. Now, I didn't go into other details. Basically, what influences this is, I mean, you may be able to calculate given x1, x2, xn certain weights which will give you a y that is exactly equal to the target. But of course, in reality, you will have noise and other things which will prevent you from doing this, okay. So, this essentially you have y, and let us say you have y naught, y minus y naught is the error, okay. And you take the mean squared error and minimize the energy in it, that is minimize the average of e square, that is what you try to do. So, then essentially even if you do not have an exact solution which will send e to 0, which will make the output exactly equal to the target, you will still minimize the error. And we also know in practice that is good enough. We want the eye to be open, we do not necessarily need the eye opening in the middle to be 100%, right. It is okay if it has some spread, but we need to have some opening, okay. So, this gradient descent algorithm, we know that E is y minus y naught, y naught is some fixed target, or right. So, essentially if you take the partial derivative of E square with respect to any coefficient, what is that? Partial derivative of the squared error with respect to any coefficient, this will just be 2 e times whatever that coefficient is multiplying, okay, 2 e times x k. So, as long as you have this available, okay, you can do this adaptation, right. And like I said, so, every coefficient, this is known as the coefficient update equation, from one step to next, it is changed based on this one, okay. So, intuitively you should understand that. So, let us say this derivative of the squared error with respect to some coefficient becomes 0, what should you do? Obviously, you should not change the coefficient any further, right. So, it has become hopefully minimum, not the maximum, but that is what it is. Then that is what the update equation also does, right. So, if e times x k is 0, okay, then you will end up with basically the coefficient not being updated any further, okay. So, this is known as the least mean square adaptation of the coefficient. It works in general for any linear combination. You have a linear combination of some n different variables, and you want the linear combination to reach some target, this is what you use. And if you look at it, all linear filters can be put into this form, okay, whether it is continuous time or discrete time or anything. The only difference is that it may not be easy to in practice to obtain these things, okay. Because after all, like, what is a filter? It is just linear combination of, in case of discrete time filters, it is a linear combination of delayed input signals, And in case of continuous time filters, it's a delayed combination of some signal and its derivatives and so on. Okay. Now, as you know, you have the feed forward equalizer in the transmitter. What kind of filter is that? It's an FIR filter, right? So it clearly fits into this type of structure. And then you have the continuous time linear equalizer in the receiver. It can be made to fit into this kind of structure because you have in the numerator you have a 0, right? 1 plus s by z 1. You separate like 1 by, I mean you separate 1 and s, that is the signal and its derivative. If you can generate those things, you can get the gradients, but it is a little more difficult. The signals are not naturally available, okay? Because the way we make the continuous time equalizer, it's like this, right? I'm not showing the biasing circuits, but this has some transfer function of the form. And if you look at these currents, that gives you, that is in this form already. I mean, you don't have this 1 and s by z 1 separately. If you have to get that, you have to use extra circuits to do that. So that's a little more complicated. And finally, you have the decision feedback equalizer that also is of this form, right? It is some linear combination of some things, and in this case the x's are easily available. What are x's? They are just the decided values, right? And its delayed version, decided value and its delayed version. So this LMS adaptation of the equalizer works most easily for the decision feedback equalizer, and in fact that's where it is needed the most, I would say. And then the continuous time linear equalizer, it's not that easy. You can try to do it, it is possible. But in practice at high speeds, you don't want to put extra circuits and so on, okay. So typically the continuous time linear equalizer, you program the equalization to some value and then leave it like that. The transmitter in principle can be adapted. The only problem is like how to send the information back from here to there, because the decision is happening at the receiver. That is, the deviation of y from the target y naught is happening at the receiver, and in the transmitter you have to change the weights. Like this is now more complicated, right? How do you send it back from there to there? So unless you have that back channel, you can't use this adaptation for the transmit equalizer. So there also you end up setting it to some particular values based on your prior knowledge of the channel and leaving it there, okay. But in principle this LMS equalization can be used. So this is the sort of exact one. Now many times you don't want to implement this, okay. By the way, this can be used, I mean this can be used in our cases. We have a sort of analog receiver, okay. I didn't talk too much about ADC based receivers where you have a very high speed ADC and then you take the digitized outputs. But once you have the digitized outputs, you can implement the same thing, okay. In fact, it's easier because you have everything in digital form. And computations are in general easy when you have everything in digital form, okay. So then it can be done, but again at high speed you may not want to do this. So this is known as sine LMS. And there are two other combinations, so that is taking the sine of E alone or taking the sine of xk alone, okay. The difference is in this case the step size is always fixed, right. In case of sine LMS, the coefficient update is always by a step equal to mu, because this will be either plus or minus 1, okay. Whereas here, when the error is very small or xk is small, the step size is smaller, which makes sense. Maybe you are already close to the minimum and you don't want to change it by a large amount. The sine LMS is screwed in that way, okay. So regardless of how close you are to the actual minimum of the error, you will jump the step by the same amount. So that's why it's important to choose a sufficiently small step, okay, because the changing step size itself could make, could cause an error, right. If you choose a very large step, let's say that minimum error occurs for this particular step, for the step either before or after that the error is large, then you have a problem, okay, because the science and LMS, you can imagine the step is not going to be fixed at a certain value. It will be jumping at least between two levels. Okay. So, in practice you have to make sure that for either value of the coefficient or the values of coefficients between it which it is jumping, the error is sufficiently small. Okay. So, you should choose mu to be sufficiently small. Is this okay? And in fact, the intuition is quite easy from something like this. Essentially, the contribution of the kth path is C k x k. Okay. And essentially, and the error is y minus y naught. Okay. So, if the error is large, then you have to reduce the contribution of every path, right. That is, if y is let us say much more than y naught, then you should try to adjust every path so that the contribution, so that y goes on decreasing. Okay. So, again that gives you two possibilities. Each path depending on the sign of x k, you have to either increase c k or decrease c k, right. So, that is basically what it is saying. Is this fine? So, intuitively also it looks, because let us say I just asked you to do this and you just had to stare at it and tell me whether to increase a particular path coefficient or decrease it. This is what you would do, right. If y was more than y naught, you would try to reduce every path's contribution. The way to reduce every path's contribution depends on whether the input to the path is positive or negative. Okay. So, that is all this is doing. Is this okay? Now, when I write this discrete time equation for the coefficient update, this is not happening at the data rate. In fact, you do not want this kind of thing to happen at the data rate. Okay. First of all, it is very difficult to implement. Even otherwise, you this is just you are supposed to take an average value of e square, right. You have to kind of take the long term average of the squared error and then update the coefficient. So, this will happen at a much slower rate than the actual data rate. Okay. So, typically what happens is, like I said, you will have the this is the actual data slicer and you may have you subtract plus and minus V naught, basically voltage levels that correspond to plus or minus 1 logic levels. Okay. And you slice them as well with the same clock. So, these are the error slices. Now, one of these will give you the error depending on the sign of data. So, you just pick the right one by multiplexing between them. Okay. Now, in reality what happens is basically you will not the exact detail will depend on the implementation, but you will have a deserializer. So, let us say 1 to 16 or something. Okay. So, if this is at 10 gigabits per second, this will be at 625 megabits per second. Okay. So, similarly you will have to deserialize the error output also. Now, you can choose one of these two and then demultiplex it, that is also possible. You do not have to demultiplex them separately and then select. Now, this coefficient update happens at the lower data rate, probably even lot lower than this. Okay. I will write the equation for the sine LMS. Now, basically you do not want to, and it is not easy to make a mu that is very small, right. Because how are these coefficients realized? For instance, I said that you can have a differential pair and its bias current can be varied or the size of the differential pair can be switched. You will have some switched transistors. You cannot have let us say 1000 switch transistors in parallel. I mean, you can have it, but again we are talking about high speed circuits. So, if you have a very large array, the parasitic capacitance will be large and that will be a problem. So, you cannot make this mu to be like very very tiny. Okay. So, what you do is essentially you try to make sure that you really want to increase the
coefficient before you do it.
That is, you average this, you compute the sin e times sin ck, but then you average it over a long time. Okay, it could be that it is saying plus this time, minus this time, plus this time, minus this time. In that case, you are better off not changing the coefficient at all, right? So, only if this average is positive over a long interval, you can say decide what is long, maybe a few tens of symbols or few hundreds of symbols or even thousands. Okay, essentially this is just to make sure that the coefficients are changing smoothly, right. So, you average this product over many symbols. Intuitively, this is like asking, hey, do I really want to change the coefficient, right? Because who knows, this is a digital signal after all. This will always give you an answer of plus or minus 1, right? Because with the sin LMS, you will never have a condition where it says don't update the coefficient. It will always say either update it in the positive or the negative direction. So, the only way to not chatter around is to average it. So, that over a long time, if you keep getting like plus 1 minus 1 plus 1 minus 1, then that means you do not have to change it. If you keep getting many plus 1s or lot more plus 1s than minus 1s, so that means that you have to increase it. Is this okay? Any questions about the DFE or the adaptation and so on? In practice, the receiver will have, I will show the single ended sort of block diagram, but everything today is fully differential. You make fully differential transmitters and receivers. Okay. So, you have the input. Let us say this is the output of the CDLE, continuous time linear equalizer, and here you have the decision slicer, which is basically a D flip flop, okay. And you have this weighted summation for the DFE. Right. So, essentially the adaptation stuff will let me show it as a decision slicer and all these delay elements C2 and so on. Okay. You can have as many types as you want. I will show the implementation later. Now, first of all, from here, you will also have the error slicers. Okay. That is, this is what computes the error from the target or the sign of the error. Okay, now you see why the sin LMS is very convenient. If you had to actually compute the error and operate with it, it would be a lot more inconvenient. Okay. So, this also has this plus minus V naught, however it is implemented. Okay, that is, it computes the error from plus minus V naught, which correspond to logic values of plus or minus 1. Okay. Now, there are a couple of things here which can be uncertain. So, let us say this is the eye diagram appearing over there. Okay. And what does it mean to have plus minus V naught? The rather, let's say this is the eye diagram on which we are making the decision. So, this is the eye diagram over here, okay, at the input of the decision slicer. And then we are adapting the equalizer so that the logic 1 corresponds to plus V0, logic minus 1 or 0 corresponds to minus V0. So, that means that the eye diagram here should be something like this, okay. The midpoint of this is plus V0, the midpoint of this is minus V0, okay. Is this fine? Now, there are other errors that may come in. First of all, the amplitude of the signal here may not correspond to this plus and minus V0. I mean, if you scale the whole thing by a certain factor, again you have missed the target, right? And the DFE alone cannot fix that, okay. So, essentially you will have, it is the same thing, it is the same linear combination business, but you will have a variable gain amplifier here, which also has to be adapted, because here we are saying that we are making decisions on an eye diagram whose logic symbols correspond to plus and minus V0, okay. Logic symbol can correspond to any voltage values, right. So, if the gain is off, those voltage values also will be off, okay. So, you have to set the gain so that the values here correspond to plus minus V0, okay. Also, you will have the linear equalizer and this VGA itself, all these things will have mismatch and offsets, okay. So, if there is mismatch and offsets, the eye diagram here on which you are making the decision will not be symmetrical about 0, okay. So, it will be skewed either to the upper side or the lower side. So, then you will also need some offset correction, that is you will need to have a fixed value or you will need to have a DC voltage V offset which can be varied, and that is also adapted using the LMS algorithm. It is still of the linear combination form, right. So, if you look at this, you just have a linear combination of a whole bunch of things. So, everything can be adapted through the LMS algorithm, okay. Is this okay? There is another reason we need the VGA, I will explain that in a moment. Is this fine? So, the way you correct for offset and gain is essentially, so let us say these are the, I will just show you visually, I mean I will not write the equations here. So, let us say this is V0 and this is minus V0, okay. If the gain is correctly set, then if you look at these, look at the values at this instant, they will be equally distributed around this, okay. If the gain is too large, then it will be skewed to the upper side, okay. And if the gain is too small, it will be skewed to the lower side. So, that is what you are trying to correct. Is this okay? So, if this value is y, okay, if you call this value y and if you call this error e, then to correct the variable gain amplifier, basically this is the quantity based on which you will correct the variable gain amplifier, okay. So, this average, the average of this has to become 0. So, you do the same coefficient update for the VGA with sin of y times sin of e, then it will become, then you can see that it is basically trying to make this, make the distribution centered, okay. You can write it down and see, it is quite easy. And similarly, for the offset, what do you think will happen? Let us say the gain is correct. How will the sampled values be distributed? I mean, value sampled at this instant be distributed if you have an offset. The whole thing will be skewed either to the upper side or the lower side. ideally you want it distributed symmetrically. If there is a positive offset, both will be like that, and if there is a negative offset, these two will be like this. You can note the difference between this and what happens with the gain error. Okay. So, for offset correction, in the coefficient update equation, what you get is just sine of E, that is all. Okay. I mean, this is what it means, right? If there is zero offset, you are equally likely to find things above and below the target, that is all. Okay. So, these are also correct, I mean, using the LMS algorithm. Okay. So, you need to have a DAC essentially, which gives you a variable voltage here, and you need to have a variable gain amplifier. We will see how to make that. Is this okay? Any questions about any of this adaptation and DFE and so on? Error at times? More than V naught. Okay, what is the? Okay, there is a lot of error then. Okay. No, no, I mean, you do have to correct it. Essentially, assuming that you have a linear channel, right? So, if there is at some instant your, so let us just take a one tap channel, I mean sorry, two tap channel, right. So, if at some point you find that you are above the target, what you are saying is, I mean, if instead of getting 100 millivolts, I get 120 millivolts, it is actually a good thing, I leave it alone. But if you have 120 millivolts, at some other point you will have 80 millivolts, okay, for some other bit combination. So, you do have to correct that. If it is a linear channel, it is going to be like that, okay. Now, the other possibility is there is a gain error such that instead of 100 you are getting 120. That may be fine, but I will explain why you may have to limit the amplitude to a certain value. Okay? But if it is ISI, it will be symmetric. So, that means that if the target is 1 and if you get 1.2, at some other point you will for sure get 0.8. Okay? All you have to do is whatever symbols are interfering with this symbol, you flip all their signs, the ISI will also get. Now, there is a reason to use a VGA to regulate the amplitude to a certain value. Again, here you may wonder why have this, like let it go to the biggest amplitude possible. Okay? What is the reason? I mean, a larger amplitude seems like it will only help, right? What may be the reason to regulate the amplitude? I mean, this is just a circuit limitation. What happens if you go on increasing the amplitude? Yes? Huh? Nonlinear, yeah. So, basically, so earlier, right, when at low data rates, when people did not have to worry about ISI and so on, right, then in fact, what you would do is you may, I mean, over a long transmission line, the signals may become small, or maybe a small signal was transmitted. Right, or because of loss it becomes small, but there is no ISI. So, then what would happen is that you would take this and you would go to what is called a limiting amplifier, LA, right. So, maybe the input data would look like this and so on. The amplitude is small and you use a limiting amplifier. Here, at least the way I have drawn it, there is no inter-symbol interference. You just make it nice big square waves. Okay. Then all you have to do is to make decisions on this at the edge of some clock, which you get from a CDR. Okay. Now, in our situation where we have significant ISI, the situation is not like this. That is, you have to remove ISI. And to do that, you have to process the signal linearly, right? Because if there is a signal with ISI and I limit it, let us say it saturates some amplifier, you cannot remove the ISI after that, okay? Because ISI is a linear phenomenon. Now, the DFE is a nonlinear equalizer, but it is still removing I mean, at this point, up to this point, right, the signal chain has to be linear, otherwise the whole thing does not work. Because the way we are subtracting ISI is assuming that to the cursor some C1 times something is added and we are subtracting that. That works only if this part is not saturated. If the path from the input to the input of the decision block is saturated, the whole thing simply does not work, right. So, that is why you have to choose this plus minus V0 so that all this amplification stuff, right, up to this point, all this addition, everything, all the linear blocks will stay linear, okay. So, that is why you cannot have a very large gain either. If you do, essentially there is no ISI, okay. Because if I take ISI meaning the ISI information is lost, the ISI will be there and because of that you would have made a wrong decision. For instance, let us say I take an eye diagram like this, I take a signal which has an eye diagram like this, it has some ISI. I put this through like a very high gain, very high bandwidth amplifier, okay. What will happen? What will the output look like? What will the output eye diagram look like? So, for instance, let us say I have a lot of ISI, okay. The eye diagram looks like this. The eye opening is actually quite small, okay. Very little eye opening. I put this through some very high gain, very high bandwidth amplifier. What will the eye diagram look like? So, vertically. So, basically it will look like this, all the transitions will be here, but in the middle of the eye it looks like it has no ISI at all, okay. Even if the eye is closed, it is going to actually look like this, right, because it is going to make a decision anyway, okay. So, now this is pointless because from this you cannot remove ISI if you do something like this, okay, because you need to know how much the ISI is, the signal has to be processed linearly before you can remove the ISI. Right. Actually, sometimes I mean you see some stupid things even in papers. You will say eye diagrams at this point. I mean the eye diagram there is going to look clean because it is a decision slicer, right. But you may have made the wrong decisions. Even if you make the wrong decisions, the eye diagram will look like it is perfectly open, okay. So, the important thing is to look at the eye diagram here at the input of the decision slicer, the eye diagram where the eye on which you are making the decision, okay. So, anyway up to this point it has to be processed linearly. So, that is why you need to have a variable gain amplifier. This compensates for length of the channel and all those things and also the circuit variability itself. On an IC the gains vary substantially, okay. So, you need to adjust the gain so that over process, temperature, everything this stays linear, the processing up to this part. The way this is implemented is the following. I mean at high speeds you can only use very simple circuits. So, let us say first of all I will show one stage of continuous time linear equalization. This is the input from the channel, okay. I'll assume that there is only like one stage of this. Then after this, you will have some amplifier, maybe this itself is the variable gain amplifier. And one possible way of making variable gain is to vary this. But of course, if you do this, its linearity also changes. So, you have to see how much, what the range of currents over which you can vary this. Or you may have multiple differential pairs in parallel and you can activate or deactivate them to get different amounts of gain, okay. I have not gone too much into circuit details in this course, but you have to take care of many details. Like for instance, if you change the current, the common mode level here changes and so on. So, those things also may have to be compensated for or somehow you have to design the circuit so that it works properly in spite of all those things. Okay. Now let's say this is, these are the nodes that go to the decision slicer. Okay. What is that? That's a D flip flop, right? And everything is differential, but yeah, let me show it like this. And there'll be some clock which comes from the clock and data recovery circuit. Okay. Now, for decision feedback equalization, what you will do is you will have to take this, delay this by a certain amount, and multiply it by a certain weight and add it back here. Okay. The way it is done is using another differential pair. Okay. And again, you change the, you could change the current source to change the gain of that path. Basically, this is the coefficient. This is the first DFE tap, and this is the coefficient C1. Okay, is this fine? So now, from this point, you will also have the error slicer. Okay, somehow you will subtract the error, and you will slice that. Okay. And not only that, you will have, I have shown one tap DFE, but to these nodes you will have many more taps. Okay. So in practice, actually what happens is this node, the summation node, will have a lot of parasitic capacitance. Okay. So that is actually designing that is quite difficult, in that you have, if you have 6 DFE taps, all of them will be summing to that node, right? So that means that you have 6 differential pairs. Not all of them will be equally sized. Basically, the size of each differential pair will be related to the maximum tap value, right? Because as you go further down, like so the 6th tap doesn't have to be as strong as the 1st tap, so you will use a smaller differential pair. But nonetheless, you will have many things summing together. At least 2 of them, right? You will have the input path and the 1st tap of the DFE, and many more taps of the DFE. On top of it, this will go not only to this decision slicer, but first of all the error slicer. And remember, you need to, essentially this clock here, this has to be optimally adjusted by the CDR based on the signal at these nodes. So these nodes are what go to the CDR as well. You know that the clock and data recovery circuit, the input signal goes to typically 2 latches, right, operating on opposite edges and so on. Okay. So the other latch in the CDR is also loading this particular node. So basically, the capacitive loading on this node okay. So this will be sort of the bandwidth bottleneck in the whole system. And of course, you need to have everything operating linearly. You can't have any of these amplifier stages, this amplifier stage saturating because of excessive voltage swing here. So that's why you need to limit the voltage swing here to some reasonable values. If you choose it to be too small, things will be linear, but you will be making more errors, right? Because the signal to thermal noise ratio will be smaller. And if you choose it to be very large, you will be affected by nonlinearity. But anyway, these days you don't have too much choice. You have about 1 volt supply. So maybe this V0 will be 100 or 200 millivolts at most. Okay? This is fine. But the important thing to remember is, compared to the case when you didn't need equalization, there actually you can buy things called limiting amplifiers. Their whole purpose was to give a lot of gain so that the whole thing gets limited to the maximum amplitude, and then you operate the CDR on that. But that doesn't work when you have significant amounts of ISI. Okay. Any questions about this? Now, the bandwidth of this is also a concern. Let's look at that. This DFE in particular, it's extremely good in that it doesn't have this noise amplification problem, right? A continuous time linear amplifier, linear equalizer amplifies noise, whereas DFE doesn't have that problem. What's that? Yeah. So where? So, okay, what you are essentially saying is that you can have an amplifier here, which doesn't have to be linear. That is correct, in that after you do the summation, right, up to this point everything is linear, and after that, after you do the summation, what he is saying is you can choose an amplifier. If this becomes non-linear, it is okay, because essentially I have removed all the ISI here and I make the decision. And okay, I won't, yeah, this is correct. Essentially, this is like using a better latch, right, which has a better sensitivity, okay. The reason to choose a certain value of V naught is we think that that is an amplitude at which the latch has a good enough sensitivity, and it doesn't have a, we haven't discussed latch circuits. What happens is, if you take a D flip flop, I mean, you would of course be very familiar with using D flip flops with digital inputs, but let's say you have inputs which are not very large, okay, they are just like, let's say, slightly positive or slightly negative. Now what happens with a flip flop is that as you reduce the input amplitude, first of all the amount of time it takes to make the decision goes on increasing, okay. Now clearly that's a very critical thing here, because we are looking at high speed communication. You have, after all, like 1 bit or maybe half a bit interval to make the decision properly. So essentially the latch has to become better and better, okay. So one way to put what you are saying is you simply use a better latch, right? That is correct. You can use an amplifier. You have to basically make sure that the amplifier also introduces delay, okay. So this whole decision making should happen within a half clock cycle, so that's another concern. But yeah, essentially if you do have a better latch, you can limit it to a smaller amplifier. That is correct, however you make the better latch. But there are two things there. One is the sensitivity of the latch, that is, what is the smallest amplitude which will be regenerated, but this has to be not seen in isolation, because any small amplitude will be regenerated if you allow it enough time. But you also have a time constraint, which is basically within a symbol period, especially with the DFE, right, because you have to feed this back by the time the next symbol comes in, okay. So the time constraint is also there. So let's say you have, again I'll draw some sort of an eye diagram. I'll draw an open eye, but I mean I'll assume that there is a reason we need the DFE. Okay. Now let's say the CDR is operating perfectly and its rising edge is here. Okay. Now essentially this is the eye diagram at the input of the slicer. So this is Y. Okay. This is Y. Now if the slicer, if the D flip flop has no clock to Q delay, I mean this is an inconceivable situation, what happens is that the output of the D flip flop will look like this. So this is the symbol interval T naught, okay, and if I extend this to another period, so whatever value is sampled at this instant, this symbol here corresponds to that value, okay. Now what should happen in decision feedback? Basically this value should get added over there, right, for the next symbol, isn't it? Basically for the next decision which will be made here, this the weighted version of this symbol must get added, okay. So in principle, basically if I have an instantaneous decision in the D flip flop, in the latch, what should be the value of tau here? I said that the output of this flip flop, right, which is making the decision, must be delayed and summed back with the input. So what should be the value of tau by looking at this diagram? What's that, Ashish? No, No, it should just come in the next symbol interval. So what should it be? This is the decided value and that should appear in the next symbol interval. So what's the delay? Time period? Half, right? Basically, so that this, if it is delayed by half, it gets aligned with the next symbol, that's all. Okay? So when I add this to this, when I add this one and this one, so in this part, the effect of the previous decision gets added. So ideally it should just be half. Okay? Is this fine? Or is there some confusion? So you just think of aligning this eye diagram with that eye diagram, that's all. Okay. So that in the next symbol interval, you have the effect of the previous decision. Okay. Okay. Now, in practice, you certainly don't expect something like this where the D flip flop has no delay. Okay. Again, we are talking about high speed data communication system, right? So, the D flip flop will have a delay and then it will kind of do something like this. On top of it, there will be some bandwidth limitation of this path from here to there. Okay, because especially I pointed out that this node has a large parasitic capacitance and is particularly slow. Okay. So, in reality, you will not have this at all. Okay. You will not have any explicit delay. In fact, you will be lucky if this whole thing works like this. Okay. Because now the clock to queue delay of the flip flop plus of the latch plus the delay in the feedback path should be less than half the symbol period. Or okay, if it is a little bit more than half a symbol period, you may still be able to tolerate it. But if it is too much more, what happens is, what happens if the delay is too much? So, okay, let us say it is not that much. I mean, I am not saying like it is off by like one symbol completely, but it is a little more than half cycle, what will happen? So, okay, let us just look at the effect on this. Ideally, with instantaneous decisions, it should be like this. I will still show this with a very sharp rise time, that also may not be the case. With a half cycle delay exactly, then this is aligned exactly with this, that is nice. Okay, the transitions of this are aligned with that. And if I have a little more delay, so something like this, what happens is the transitions of the input, let us say the transitions coming from the input path are at some time, the transitions of the feedback path are later. So, it actually increases the jitter, although it improves the vertical eye opening. Okay. So, it actually makes the jitter worse and the horizontal eye opening here can get worse. And of course, as the delay goes on increasing, it just does not work at all. Like you said, it will go off to the next symbol period. So, the bottleneck in realizing the DFE is closing this first tab. It is actually quite difficult. I mean, it is possible, but if you go to like higher speeds, you will have to think of something else. Is it okay? Because the flip, mainly because, I mean, first of all, this is a low bandwidth node because you have a large number of taps adding in, it is likely to have high capacitance. So, the delay of this feedback amplifier, right, the feedback tap, if you think of this as an amplifier with some parasitic load, that will be high. On top of it, this decision slicer, if it is making a decision from a small amplitude, that also will be something. Now, and again, like everything has to be seen in the context of very high speeds that we are operating. So, it is possible to complete this, but again at very high speeds or at very high speeds, you may not be able to do this. Or even if you do, you may end up burning too much power in the latch and the amplifier and so on. Okay. So, there is some way out of this, you can think about what that might be. Basically, you try not to complete the loop around this one. So that we'll discuss more. Yeah, if it is less than t by 2 also it the jitter increases, but that is easy to fix. You can add a small delay. So in general, I mean, this, by the way, this is a sort of analog implementation of the equalizer, but even if you have a digital implementation, you still need to close this feedback path, okay. So you will have some decision which is a digital decision block, and then that output will be the symbol will be multiplied by something, okay, some scaling, and then you have to add it back to the input, and this all has to happen within one clock cycle, okay. And you do know that, I think you have a state machine with the feedback. There are critical paths, right? So this will be the critical path even in a digital implementation of the DFE, okay. So closing the first tap is very, can be difficult, and there are other ways around it which we will see, okay.